I used to wake up in a dope spot and turn my swag on. Wasn't hopping out the bed cause I was sleeping on the floor. Back then y'all was sleeping on the floor. Used to get it on the block, I had to keep it on the low. My cash grow like Pinocchio's nose. Bulletproof 7 series, yeah, we.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Middle Bar Friday for Friday, May 24th, 2019. This is episode 101. And today we're talking about subscribing to Azure Blockchain Ethereum events using Azure Logic Apps. Now, this has the potential to be a very long series or a lot of content, so I've decided to break this apart. So today we're just going to focus on part one, which is subscribing to these events. And then in future episodes, we'll actually dive into more details. Now, recently, just before the Build event in Seattle earlier this May, Microsoft announced fully managed Azure Blockchain Service. They've actually been making quite a few waves in this area, whether it be the Workbench platform or just the Azure Blockchain Service itself, which provides the ability to use essentially Ethereum, and more specifically, there's the ability to provision a consortium version of this blockchain, which allows enterprises to be able to use this technology. So for the purpose of this episode, I am using the Azure Blockchain Service that does exist inside of Azure. Now, I do recommend for more info, the Azure Blockchain team has a series of videos called Block Talk on Channel 9. So if this is of interest to you, I highly recommend going and watching these videos. And there's several on there. As you can see, there's 33. So you're going to get a lot of background on what Microsoft is doing with specifically as it pertains to blockchain. Now, what I'm going to do today is just talk about subscribing to blockchain events. In a future episode, we're going to talk about publishing blockchain events to the, you know, Ethereum blockchain implementation inside of Azure. Now, it can be a little bit confusing, and unfortunately, a lot of the content that exists there today doesn't go into a whole lot of details on how you do this, which is quite unfortunate. Now, so what I'm going to do is I have on the left-hand side of the screen here, and I do have some credentials blocked out, so apologies for that. But this essentially is my Azure Blockchain Service that I've gone ahead and provisioned. Now, if I go ahead and click on the access keys for a transaction node, and a transaction node is kind of like a consortium version of a miner. When you have these consortium implementations, you don't have the miner where you're actually earning Ether like you might on public blockchain, so it's a little bit different. But essentially, this provides me connection strings through access keys that allows me to connect to blockchain instance itself. So in this case, I've got a trigger, and I need to establish a connection. So I have to provide a connection name, which is no surprise. But I also have to provide my Ethereum RPC endpoint, which in this case could be my HTTPS, which is part of access key one. You do have two keys. And I can go ahead and click Create. Now, subtle difference here. You'll see private key. If you've done any blockchain before, you'll know how important this is that a private key is used to sign a transaction before it actually gets put into the Ethereum network. Now, when you are subscribing, you're not signing anything. And the whole idea with blockchains is that they are very transparent. So you can see all of the transactions that exist on a blockchain. So when you're subscribing, you don't need a private key. But to put a message on the blockchain, you do need a private key, and that's what we're going to talk about in an upcoming episode. All right, so now that we've got our connection established, let's talk about the trigger. So the first thing we want to talk about is the smart contract address. So you can kind of think of this as kind of like an IP address or DNS, where it's the location of your smart contract on the Ethereum blockchain. And so in this case, I've got sort of a single node Ethereum blockchain, a private implementation, but this basically corresponds to the smart contract where it lives inside of that network, which we've established a connection to. Now, let's take a look. I'm using a tool called Remix. Remix is basically a web-based IDE for developing Ethereum smart contracts. Now, this is the equivalent of a Hello World smart contract, where we, you know, essentially have a contract called My Post Box, and then we've got a few different attributes here: a string message, an int64 count, and an event. And you can kind of think of whenever an event is emitted, and that's what's happening here, that's what we're going to go ahead and subscribe to when we talk about this event name here. So this is a very simple, it's kind of like an echo type solution where we can provide, say, a value, and we can basically provide a sum of the value and basically tell how many times that this actually has been called. Now, once we've gone ahead and compiled it through this tab, we have the ability to deploy it. So we've done that, and once it's deployed, we're going to have essentially a deployed contract, which is going to have a contract address, which we can simply copy from here, go ahead and paste it in this box, and then we can now focus on the contract ABI. Now, the contract ABI, and I'm going to paraphrase from Stack Exchange a bit here, but in general, the ABI is the interface between two program modules, one of which is often at the level of machine code. The interface is the de facto method for encoding, decoding data into out of machine code. So you can kind of think of this basically as our contract in terms of our inputs and outputs into our smart contract itself. Now, once again, once we have the code compiled, we have the ability to go ahead and retrieve this data from the compile tab. And we can simply just click on this icon here, and we're going to copy the ABI, and we can paste it into this box. Now, this is an example of the ABI that we had just generated. So, you know, it's what you would expect. It's your inputs, your outputs. If you've got events defined, those are all going to show up here. And once Logic Caps has had the ability to then connect to the smart contract address, we've provided the smart contract address, once we've provided the ABI, then we're going to actually see an event name basically made available to us called posted, and this is what Logic Apps is going to subscribe to on the actual blockchain itself. Now, do note this is an interval or polling based trigger, so naturally we're going to poll, and we have the ability to change this value to one that suits our needs. Okay, here we are inside of Logic Apps. Very simple Logic App. We've got a trigger. It's going to connect to the Ethereum network, and then we're just going to post our message to RequestBin just using HTTP. So we've shown this before, the contract ABI. We've got the smart contract address, and then we also have the event, which is posted. And then what we're going to do is, it's not a whole lot of dynamic content here, but we basically have a message attribute as part of the body output, and we're gonna send that over to RequestBin. Okay, so here we are, we're back in our Remix smart contract editor. Let's go ahead, since this is basically an echo service, we can just provide a number, let's just say put 29. We can see how many times I've called the smart contract, so it's currently 2. So I'm going to go ahead and provide a post here. Now, this is just part of the Remix editor where I do have to provide a password here. So we'll go ahead and do that. We'll go ahead and click on OK. Now we can see that we are trying to transact and put our message on the blockchain. And we can see that there it is now there. So let's go ahead and refresh this. We should see this number get updated to be 29. It is. Let's go ahead and get count. And we can now see that that's 5, because I had tested it before as well. Now let's head over to Logic Apps itself. Let's just do a refresh. And we can see, well, it hasn't, those are those other runs that I was talking about. And then so let's go ahead and click on smart contract. We see it just ran. Let's go take a look at the outputs. We should see 29 here, which we do. Then we'll go ahead and send this value of 29 over to RequestBin. Let's go ahead and refresh that. And sure enough, we can see our message has been put over in request bin. So what are some practical applications of this? And I think naturally when you have a blockchain, they don't scale all that well at this point. Like transaction throughput is a bit of an issue. Also, you don't want to do reporting off of a blockchain directly, right? It's not an efficient query mechanism. So what you can do is actually subscribe to events that are occurring on the blockchain and then actually move them over to better data sources. Like that could be a database, say SQL database, where I could then go ahead and, you know, build queries against that database. I might also want to communicate with other like line of business enterprise systems as well. And by subscribing to different events, I can go ahead and do that effectively. You're not going to have, you know, code on the blockchain that's going to talk to your SAP instance or a CRM. That's where you can actually use logic apps and basically subscribe to these events that are occurring on the blockchain, grab that value, that data, and then actually use it to integrate with other systems. So hopefully that provides you some good information on blockchain and logic apps. As I mentioned, we'll do another series or another part in this series in a couple weeks' time, and we'll focus on publishing events to a blockchain, and then we'll kind of see where we're at that point, see if there's more content worth sharing. If you're watching this on integrationusergroup.com, that's cool. If you're watching this on YouTube, go ahead and click that like and subscribe button just so that you are kept up to date whenever new episodes are published. I want to thank BizTalk360 for being a great partner of the show. Go ahead and check out their website. Also, if you haven't signed up for Integrate, your time is coming to an end here soon as the event in London is just around the corner. So I would encourage you to go ahead and sign up for that if you are interested. So take care, have a great weekend, and thanks for tuning in to Middleware Friday. Out of old foes, out of every new, but I'm the one the city chose. Now can't a motherfucker knock me up my soul, and that's why I'm feeling myself. I'm feeling myself. I'm so fresh and I can't help it. I'm so fresh and I can't help it.